In this video, we see how the ellipsoid method can be used to solve linear programming optimization problems in polynomial time. So far, we have only seen how the ellipsoid method can be used to solve in polynomial time a linear programming feasibility problem. So the first question that we should ask ourselves is, can we solve an optimization problem by solving a feasibility problem? And the answer is yes. Let's see how we can do this. Let's say that the linear programming problem that we want to solve is minimize C transpose X subject to AX greater than or equal to B. We write down the dual of our linear programming problem, which is maximize P transpose B subject to A transpose P equal to C and P greater than or equal to 0. Now we use a strong duality. In particular, strong duality implies that both the primal and the dual have optimal solutions if and only if we have a primal feasible solution and a dual feasible solution with the same costs. In other words, if and only if the following system is feasible: AX greater than or equal to B for primal feasibility, A transpose P equal to C and P greater than or equal to 0 for dual feasibility, and finally P transpose B equal to C transpose X, in order for the two solutions to have the same cost. Now we denote by capital Q the set of points XP that satisfy all these linear constraints. We then apply the ellipsoid method to decide whether Q is non-empty. Now let's say that the ellipsoid method tells us that Q is non-empty and it returns a point XP in Q. Then, by strong duality, X is an optimal solution to our original linear programming problem, and P is an optimal solution to its dual. On the other hand, if the ellipsoid method tells us that Q is empty, then, again from strong duality, we know that our original linear programming problem doesn't have an optimal solution. However, here there is a little problem that we are actually ignoring. We have seen in the previous sections that our ellipsoid method is able to understand if Q is empty or non-empty. However, if Q is non-empty, it is not always able to return a vector in Q. In fact, the ellipsoid method is able to return a vector in Q, if Q is non-empty, under the assumption that Q is full-dimensional. However, if Q is not full-dimensional, recall that we need to perturb Q in order to obtain the polyhedron Q epsilon. And then the ellipsoid method is applied to Q epsilon. Therefore, if Q is non-empty, then the ellipsoid method returns a vector in Q epsilon, and this vector does not necessarily belong to Q. This is a technical difficulty that fortunately can be solved. In fact, since our epsilon is very small, it is possible to perturb the obtained vector in Q epsilon in order to obtain a vector in Q. And this can be done with a suitable rounding procedure. This fact that we are not going to discuss in more details, together with theorem 8.3, leads to the following fundamental theorem for linear programming optimization problems. The LP problem with integer data can be solved in polynomial time under the bit model using the ellipsoid method. Next, we are going to discuss an alternative way to solve the linear programming optimization problem by recursively solving feasibility problems. This is a method that doesn't require the construction of the dual and is called the sliding objective ellipsoid method. In the sliding objective ellipsoid method, we start by solving the most obvious feasibility problem. Namely, we run the ellipsoid method to find simply a feasible solution, if any exists. Let's say that our ellipsoid method finds a vector x0 in our polyhedron P. In order to proceed, I need to mention that the ellipsoid method can also be applied to linear programming problems involving strict inequality constraints. Now the idea is very simple. We look at the cost of our vector x0 and we search for a vector in P with cost strictly lower than that of x0. So in the next iteration, we apply the ellipsoid method to the set P intersected the points in Rn with cost strictly smaller than the cost of x0. The ellipsoid method will then tell us if the set is empty or not. If it is empty, then x0 is optimal. Otherwise, if it is non-empty, it will find a new solution x1 in P with cost strictly smaller than that of x0. In other words, C transposed x1 is strictly smaller than C transposed x0. The algorithm then proceeds in this way recursively. And we have a picture at the bottom of the slide that represents the situation. Let's say this is our polyhedron P, and in iteration t we have found the vector xt in P. Then, in the next iteration, we consider the intersection of P with the strict inequality C transpose x strictly smaller than C transposed xt. In the picture, this is the part of the original polyhedron above this line. So it is this set over here. In this example, this set is non-empty. Therefore, the ellipsoid method will return a vector xt plus 1 with the strictly lower cost. For example, this vector over here. At the next iteration, the ellipsoid method will consider the intersection of P with the strict inequality C transpose X strictly smaller than C transposed XT plus 1. So it will consider the region over here. In particular, at every iteration, we add a constraint in the direction of the cost vector C. All these constraints are then parallel to each other, and this explains the name of the algorithm. Essentially, we keep sliding the hyperplane corresponding to the objective function. Note that, as opposed to our previous primal dual approach, the sliding objective ellipsoid method doesn't give us any guarantee on how many iterations we need to find an optimal solution to our optimization problem. So the sliding objective ellipsoid method doesn't result in a polynomial time algorithm for linear programming. However, there's a variation of the sliding objective ellipsoid method that actually achieves a polynomial running time. This method is in a sense a combination of the sliding objective ellipsoid method and of binary search. However, in this course, we're not going to present this method. Next, let's discuss the performance of the ellipsoid method in practice. First, let's briefly recap the performance of the ellipsoid method in theory. We have seen that the ellipsoid method solves linear programming problems in big O of n to the 6 log n u iterations. In each iteration, the number of arithmetic operations performed is polynomial in n and in log u. So the total number of arithmetic operations is polynomial in n and log u. Hence, the worst-case running time of the ellipsoid method is much better than the worst-case running time of the simplex method, which can be exponential in n. So from a theoretical point of view, the ellipsoid method is much better than the simplex method. But what about the efficiency in practice of these two algorithms? Unfortunately, in practice, the ellipsoid method is very slow. And this is because it needs a very large number of iterations, even on moderate-sized linear programming problems. On the other hand, the simplex method needs a small number of iterations on most practical linear programming problems. Essentially, what happens is that while the ellipsoid method achieves its worst-case running time on most problems, the simplex method on most problems is much faster than its worst-case. This means that we have a clear mismatch between theory and practice. And so we shouldn't identify polynomial time algorithms with efficient algorithms in practice. The intrinsic reason why we cannot identify these two classes of problems is that when we discuss polynomial time algorithms, we insist on a universal polynomial bound for all instances of the problem. And so while the ellipsoid method achieves a polynomial bound for all instances, it typically exhibits a slow convergence. Of course, one might wonder if the ellipsoid method can be improved in order to accelerate the convergence. There are several attempts of this type in the literature, like for example the idea of deep cuts. Unfortunately, so far, none of the proposed improvements was able to fundamentally improve the speed of convergence. So all in all, the ellipsoid method did not revolutionize a linear programming problem from a practical perspective. However, it has shown that linear programming is efficiently solvable from a theoretical point of view. While this does not directly result in a practically efficient method, this is really important, because most of the times, when a problem is shown to be efficiently solvable from a theoretical point of view, Shortly after, researchers are able to develop new algorithms which are efficient both from a theoretical perspective and a practical perspective. For linear programming, this has been the case with interior point methods. This method makes use of the key geometric idea of the ellipsoid method and uses it in a completely different way in order to obtain efficiency both from a theoretical and practical perspective.